In the last video, we saw how to decompose a function as a sum of sine waves. In other words, we found a basis for the space L2 of the unit interval consisting of sine waves. Now, in this video, we're going to look at a different basis. This basis was actually discovered over 100 years ago by Alfred Haar, but it is very much akin to the stuff that has been going on in the last 30 years on wavelets, which have since been used for a lot of signal processing. So our very first function is just going to be the function 1. So there it is. There's a picture of our function h0. h0 of t is 1 for all points between 0 and 1. Our next function is going to be our square. It's going to be 1 between 0 and 1/2 and negative 1 between 1/2 and 1. And these guys are orthogonal because if you multiply them together and you integrate, you're integrating 1 from 0 to 1/2 and negative 1 from 1/2 to 1, and that adds up to 0. The next function is a scrunched up. You take this function and you squeeze it sideways and make it taller. So instead of being positive and then negative over the entire interval, it's positive and then negative in the first half of the interval. It's root 2 up to 1/4, and then minus root 2 from 1/4 to 1/2, and then it's 0. The next function does the same bit of going root 2 and minus root 2, only it does it between 3/4 and 1. Between half and 3/4 and 3/4 and 1. And then the next four functions are even more squeezed. They either do it between 0 and 1/4, or between 1/4 and 1/2, or between 1/2 and 3/4, between 3/4 and 1. So I've drawn a picture of the one that does it between 1/2 and 3/4. It goes positive between 1/2 and 5/8, then goes negative between 5/8 and 3/4. And you can see that any two of these are going to be orthogonal, because the ones of the same generation, they live in different places. You know, that this function, the green function, is orthogonal to the red function because they don't overlap. The product of the two is zero everywhere. Functions of different generations are going to be orthogonal because this averages to zero and the other function would be a constant value between 1/2 and 3/4. So these functions give us information, and it's both localized. See, this function tells us something about what's happening between 1/2 and 3/4, and it has a certain length scale. And we get things that are working at smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller length scales. And eventually, we get to things that are so small that we don't care anymore. And those are the things that we can throw away with minimal loss of resolution. So these functions are orthogonal. In fact, they're orthonormal. If you want to figure out what a coefficient is, you just multiply the function you're dealing with by this h function, and that's just going to be the integral of the original function from, say, 0 to 1/4 minus 1/4 to 1/2, or 0 to 1/2 minus 1/2 to 1. You just wind up integrating the original function over an interval minus the integral of the original function over a slightly different interval. So the coefficients are very easy to compute, and this gives us resolution of a signal. The same ideas can work in two dimensions. If we're thinking about functions on the unit square rather than functions on the unit interval, here's a function. It's 1 everywhere on the whole square. Here's another function. It's 1 on the lower half and negative 1 on the upper half. These are orthogonal because if you multiply them together and integrate over the whole square, you get 0. Here's another function that's 1 over 1/2 and negative 1 over the other half. It's orthogonal to this. It's also orthogonal to this. If you multiply these two together, you get 1 on these corners minus 1 on these corners, and it integrates out to 0. Here's another function that's orthogonal to these two and to this. To get more functions, you do the same thing, only in a corner. You make it 0 everywhere in the three other corners, and in the corner you have something that looks like these three. scaled up by 2, so when you square them and integrate them, you still get 1. And then you have 3 more functions that live in this region, 3 more that live in this region, 3 more that live in this region. And at the next generation, you have 3 that live in this corner, 3 that live in this corner, 3 in this corner, 3 in this corner, 3 in this, 3, and so on. And if you take a function and decompose it in this way, if it's a reasonably smooth function, the coefficients drop off very, very, very quickly. And so if you only keep the first dozen terms, the first 2 dozen terms, or the first 100 terms, or the first 1,000 terms, you get a good approximation to your function. And if you have an image, you decompose it in these bases, and you throw away the high-frequency stuff, and you'll get a picture that involves much, much less data storage that looks nearly as good to the human eye. And that's exactly how pictures are stored on computers. It's not literally these functions. It's a more sophisticated wavelet than these functions. But the essential idea is the same as the idea of these functions. You decompose things in a basis. The first few terms give you what's happening on a large scale, then the next few terms give you a smaller scale, then smaller, then smaller, and smaller. And eventually you get to things that are smaller than the eye can reasonably see, and you can throw those away with negligible loss of accuracy.